Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Patty Barron, and I'm the Director of Family Readiness for the Association of the United States Army. And we at AUSA are thrilled to partner. Oh, thank you. We at AUSA are thrilled to partner with the Military Family Research Institute today to bring you this moderated discussion titled A Battle Plan to Support Military and Veteran Families, as well as host the presentation of the Excellence in Research on Military and Veteran Families Award later on this afternoon. I also want to welcome our virtual audience. I know we've got a wonderful virtual audience watching us right now, and so thank you for joining us and being a part of today's discussion. But before we begin, I have the pleasure of inviting to the podium Lieutenant General Guy Swan, who will make some brief opening remarks. Lieutenant General Swan is the Vice President of Education for the Association of the United States Army. He's an experienced leader with a stellar resume, which includes Director of Operations, United States Northern Command, and Chief of Army Legislative Command. He's also my boss. So ladies and gentlemen, a warm welcome for Lieutenant General Swan.
What Patty didn't tell you is that we all take orders from Patty around here, especially when it comes to military families. But on behalf of our president, General Retired Carter Hamm, let me welcome you to the AUSA Conference and Event Center. And before I go any further, a shameless plug for this wonderful facility is available for your use at a nominal fee. This has been open about a little over a year now, and we've had a variety of events in here. In fact, last night, General Hamm is out right now working with new Army Brigadier Generals in kind of a mentorship role on behalf of the Chief of Staff of the Army. In fact, that group was in this room last night along with General Colin Powell. So we do a lot of events in this room, a lot of capability. Patty mentioned live stream. We've got catering, so a shameless plug if you want to use this facility. Let me, at the risk of not introducing or recognizing all of the VIPs in the room, I would like to recognize two folks before we start, and that is my old friend Mary Winnefeld. I formerly worked for her husband, the former vice chairman of the Joint Chiefs, Sandy Winnefeld. So, Mary, thanks for being here. Great. And of course, Dr. Shelley MacDermid Wadsworth here is from MFRI, is really our host today, and we're glad you're here, Shelley, as well. Let's give her a hand. Now, many of you attended the MFRI Battle Plan for Supporting Families last September. Patty and I had the opportunity to join you and many of you for that forum, and the goal of the symposium was to define messages and actions for future leaders centered around military and veterans' families the next time we have to put a large number of troops in the field. And we're all cognizant of that we have folks in the field today in harm's way, and we keep them in our thoughts and prayers, especially as we go into this holiday season. Several of you were in the room or participated in that event last year, and I know you're anxious to discuss some of the outcomes of that great event. We at AUSA are committed to supporting Army families as well as all service families through a variety of pillars in our program that's headed up by Patty Barron: information, education, advocacy, and outreach. And today is an example of how we bring timely and current topics to our members, our senior military leaders, and our military families. We look forward to a great discussion here today on events facing military families. I talked with Shelley just briefly that, you know, we're now into a presidential transition. We're into that very awkward period as one president leaves, another president comes in. And the discussion and focus on military families could get caught up in all of that expected turmoil that's going to go on over the next few months. That's why it's very important for groups like this and forums like this to continue to keep that focus on our military families as we make that transition. Before I hand it back over to Patty, I do want to, on behalf of all of us at AUSA, wish all of you a happy Thanksgiving. We're getting into the holiday season. And on a personal note, I want to just leave you with this thought. I am a retiree. I am a veteran. I'm a parent of a newly minted Army second lieutenant. I'm a parent of a very proud Army brat daughter who is over at James Madison. So I am one of the beneficiaries of your discussions here today. And on behalf of my family and all of us here at AUSA, thanks for what you do. And with that, I'll turn it back over to Patty. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. I do want to also introduce another member of our executive leadership team, and that is Lieutenant General retired Pat McQuistion, who is our VP of Membership and Meetings. Thank you, ma'am, for being here. And that's a female power, yay. So now it's my honor to introduce our co-host and moderator for the day, Dr. Shelley MacDermid Wadsworth. You can read her bio in the program, but I can't let this opportunity go by without thanking Shelley for her commitment to and passion for military families. I can honestly say that the work that you do, Shelley, on behalf of military families absolutely counts, and I am honored that you are with us today. Thank you so much, Shelley.
Thank you very much for such a kind welcome, and I want to also thank General Hamm and General Swan for their support of this scheme that Patty and I dreamed up quite a long time ago. This represents a new stage, really, in the relationship between MFRI and some of the organizations that really work on behalf of military families, and of course, in this case, specifically the Association of the United States Army. And it's very appropriate because, of course, the association, as you've heard, is very interested in advocating on behalf of all components of the Army. And if you've been to their conference, you know that Patty organizes every year a very extensive set of sessions about family interests that engage the highest levels of leadership of the Department of Defense. And she brings some of the best scholars in the country, some of the most knowledgeable experts in the country, to that forum. And so what we're doing here today is very much in line with all of that. Later today, we'll be announcing the winner of this year's research award, and that also is a new stage in our partnership, where at MFRI, one of our goals is to try to shrink the distance between science and policy and practice. And we know that many of you who are here are doing this work every day. You're very well read. You know the experts. You're paying close attention. But there's so much work that gets done that it's hard to know what the good stuff is and all the different places that it appears. And so awards like this are an opportunity to try to curate, if you will, some of the highlights of that literature. But such a partnership, it's essential to have someone who has a way to get it into the hands of practitioners and who can speak that language. I spend too much time in the library to speak the language well, always, of policy, practice, and programs. And so this partnership really is very organic and interwoven, and I hope it's the beginning of something that will continue. And I'm especially admiring of AUSA for expressing this interest in science and research and engaging with the scholarly community and other communities to try to help push our thinking forward and the quality of our work forward and our frontiers of knowledge. So I just am so appreciative and grateful to all of you for coming. So thank you for that. So 100 years ago, our country was engaged in the war to end all wars. Today, it seems that we're engaged in the war that will never end. How far we have come to sort of end up where we were, in a way, I suppose. Today's event, as you heard from General Swan, is a continuation of work begun more than a year ago by leaders across our society to reflect about what they and their organizations have learned in the past 15 years. But more important, to reflect about the guidance they want to offer to the leaders who will be in their places the next time it becomes apparent that transformational change is required to support military and veteran families. We don't know when that day is. It could be today. Maybe it'll be next week. Maybe it'll be January. Maybe it will be 5 years from now. But transformational change will come, and we want to make sure that all of the lessons that have been learned in the last 15 years are available to the leaders at that time. That's what this effort is about. The effort really began 2 years ago because we started conversations about would it make sense to have such a meeting. You all go to tons of meetings. There are lots of discussions about who should do what and lessons learned. And we weren't sure that we could create something that would be different in any way. But we received a tremendous amount of encouragement. I want to especially acknowledge Joyce Razor, who was very supportive, and I also want to acknowledge Kathy Roth-Duquet, who's one of the organizers of the White Oak retreats. And it was really at White Oak where we kind of murder-boarded the idea, if you will, and I was running around all day with notes, and people were like, no, that would never work. Don't do that. And invite that. You have to do that. And it was very helpful. I came away with a plan that I thought maybe we could try. So September a year ago, representatives of about 20 different sectors of society came together to talk about their sector, to teach others about their sector, to speculate and reflect about what really went well in their sector, what was difficult, what caught them by surprise, what do they think, what do they wish they had known, what would they like to tell to their future selves. And a large group of authors has since that time been working on chapters to try to capture this knowledge. And then there's a large group of reviewers who have been reading chapters and offering feedback. So this is kind of a scholarly community, if you will, of people who are engaging in these ideas. And we're getting close to, you know, being done and putting it to bed and then getting it out into the hands of people who are in the positions to implement a battle plan at that future time that it's needed. We want people to be thinking about these ideas. The ideas are more important. I'm not here to sell books. I'm here to engage people in a task. And there are several people in the room who have been involved in one way or another. Can you just raise your hands? There are authors. Raise them high. Yeah, yes, that's right. There's quite a few who have been involved in one way or another. So the way the panel will work is that I have some questions for them just to stimulate discussion, but I hope that they will engage with each other and share ideas, and I'll open it up to all of you periodically so that you can ask questions or share ideas. I will ask that you wait for a microphone to get to you since we are live streaming. We don't want to stiff our web-based audience. Feel free to ask whatever questions you like or tell your stories. And if you think of ideas, if something gets you thinking about something that you think ought to be captured somewhere, let us know, because we're still writing the final chapter to try to crystallize the ideas, and there may be things that we're missing. So our panelists today are all authors of chapters, and I thank them for their work. You probably all know at least some of them, if not all of them. Barbara Thompson is here. She's the director of the Office of Family Readiness Policy in the Office of the Secretary of Defense, and you have more extensive bios in your packets. Joyce Razor on the far end is here. She's the executive director of the National Military Family Association. Morgan Sammons is here. He's the executive officer of the National Register of Health Service Psychologists. And Meredith Claycamp is here. Meredith is the director of the Center for Research on Military Organization at the University of Maryland. So with that, I'm going to just kick it off with a kind of warm-up question to let each of you share as you wish. But I'd like to give you an opportunity to let people in the room know a little bit about your sector. Because one of the things that we run into, I think, in this space is that it's easy to assume that everybody knows what we do and what we have to bring to the table. But I think sometimes what we've learned is that we don't understand each other as well as perhaps we thought. And so if each of you would like to just take a few moments and describe your function and what your sector is made up of, that would be great. Would you like to start, Barbara?
Good afternoon, everybody. So the Office of Family Readiness Policy is the oversight office from the Secretary of Defense that looks at family support programs and follows trends, looks at research, develops policy, and one of the changes as a result of the conflicts was we started to execute programs. Normally that's left up to the services to provide those services, but we actually got into the execution mode. So the portfolio consists of families with special needs, child and youth programs, family support programs, spouse education and career opportunities, and I'm trying to think of family advocacy. That's the last issue in my portfolio.
Great, thank you. Morgan?
Greetings, I'm Morgan Salmons. I'm actually retired Navy, so I'm feeling a little, well, never mind. I think I'm up here because my prior role as the clinical specialty leader for Navy clinical psychology when I was on active duty, and I also worked for the Navy Surgeon General as his special assistant for traumatic brain injury and psychological health. I worked with a number of people who are here, Colonel Campese and others, and then working at the Marine Corps, helping to organize a mental health response to the numerous challenges presented by returning service members and their families, and I've tried to continue that work as a retiree.
Hi, I'm Meredith. As an academic researcher, I come to looking at military families and I come to serving military families through the lens of a person who's a college professor, first and foremost. What that means, I think, from my sector, from the research sector, at least the academic research sector, is unlike others who are here who have a mission to serve, to provide programs, to get involved in people's lives, academics have a reputation of being somewhat distant, somewhat removed from the problems, which, you know, may be a feature or a bug depending on your perspective. I like to think of my somewhat distant perspective as a feature because I don't feel that in the research community we're necessarily tied or invested in the success of our particular policy program or what have you, but we're looking to find out what works, why it works, what's happening, why it's happening, to be able to inform those people who are producing the policies and programs and services so that they can do the best job mm-hmm. possible.
Thank you.
What a great lead-in. I'm Joyce. I represent the advocacy sector here today. And when I say advocacy, I'm talking much broader than lobbying. I'm talking about folks who organize in a way to take information, to listen to our constituents, respond, tell the stories of the people we serve in order to achieve change, new support, strengthening programs, whatever, to respond to whatever the need is. And then we hope to measure how that change is actually working. Prior to the start of the war, most of the advocacy work done for military people, which includes families, was done through the Military Coalition, which is an umbrella organization of 33 military and veteran organizations. The story of the war, as we'll probably get to, is that advocacy effort expanded beyond that coalition to include a lot more people, and that's the story.
Great. Thank you. And you might be interested in knowing that other sectors that are participating in this effort come from corporate America, higher education, journalism, professional associations, nonprofits, philanthropy, and a variety of folks from sectors that generate knowledge and then disseminate knowledge. It comes out of the recognition that DOD and VA can't deal with this all on their own, and they can't stop others who want to help, which is a good thing, but it can also make the landscape kind of chaotic. And so bringing sectors together to learn about each other and think about ways that they might be able to find greater synergy, even greater synergy in the future, seem to be a worthwhile goal. Well, I'm sure that on September 12, 2001, none of you could have predicted exactly what would be coming. And it's also my impression that at different points, it became clear in different sectors that transformational change would be required, and as a result of different kinds of events. So I don't know who wants to start. I don't want to, you know, just make it that we go down the line every time, but does anybody want to kind of jump in with what kind of smacked you in the face in terms of, oh my goodness, incremental change is not going to do it here. Being an insider, I guess, Barbara, it might have come to you first. Do you want to talk a little bit about that, and then we can open it to others?
I would say that on September 12, 2001, we were setting up the Pentagon Family Assistance Center at the Sheraton Hotel. Nobody had any clue of, you know, that this would be happening to us. Luckily, we had some experience with the coal and other contingencies that were not quite as horrific as 9/11. But I think what we recognized early on was that, you know, this was going to be a major event, but I don't think anybody realized that it was going to be the length of this event and that the deployments were going to be as many and as long, and how that was going to impact families in particular in my world. The other area that I think that became clear from the beginning, that we did not have a handle on how do we support geographically dispersed military families. So how do we support the Guard and Reserve? Our world was installation-based, active duty. Those were our policies. That was our focus. But we recognized early on that had to change. And how do we reach those families who are not near a military installation? So those were the two big, I think, aha moments for us, is how do we handle this, the length and the duration of deployments and the impact on families and children in particular, and then how do we take care of the Guard and Reserve families?
And can you just say, just as a follow-up, can you say a little bit about the timing of those things? Like, I don't think it was probably immediately apparent, right? Like, when were the transformational moments for you, do you think, along the way?
I think it was, you know, when we started thinking about non-medical counseling and the impact that after a while that you saw that these deployments were lasting more than 6 weeks, that it was going to be protracted, and we realized that we needed to do something to support the non-medical counseling, the life coaching, talking to somebody about those issues, giving families support that they need somebody to talk to who is a licensed clinician who knows how to help and help them develop a plan. So I would say 6 months into it, when we saw things really happening, that this wasn't going to go away. Mm-hmm. That's, I would.
How about turning points for others of you?
Joyce? Well, I think for us, September 12th, while the Pentagon folks were working on the Family Assistance Center, we were starting to get calls from Guard and Reserve families whose service member had been called up as first responder or to guard the airports and the bridges. And so right away, we knew this was different. I mean, we hadn't even sent the first troops into Afghanistan yet, but we already had this huge outpouring of need from troops, from military families who hadn't considered themselves military families before. And so for us, that wake-up call came very early. There were opportunities that came later out of that call-up, those call-ups of the National Guard and Reserve. But and also, you know, highlighting it wasn't just the support for the families of the dispersed families. It was also just the support for families of the traditional non-deployers. We had old guard troops doing cleanup in the Pentagon, and we had a spouse of an old guard member, Army member, on our staff who said, I don't know how to deal with what my husband's bringing home after that day in the Pentagon, and nobody ever thought the old guard would need a family support group. And so right away we were seeing some of those things that we hadn't seen before. Desert Storm, the effort was all about help the deployed troops, get the family readiness groups for the deployers. This was a whole new issue for us. Mm-hmm.
I won't speak on behalf of all researchers, but this for this researcher anyway, I would echo the dramatic and sustained call-up of Guard and Reserve troops. We know from history that this was what we baked into the cake, that we would need to do this, but when we actually had to call upon them, I think it felt it felt like we were somewhat unprepared. In the research community, I can tell you, this isn't, there aren't great indicators in the kind of data that you might use to try to tell stories about what's happening for folks in the military. There aren't necessarily great sources of information about that population. I'm not convinced there still are great sources of information about that population. And so even once we saw that that was a problem, we didn't have a great way to try to offer information about it. I will say, once the war started, this is all sort of, this sounds a little like September 12th yeah. through, you know, January 1st of 2002. I think the real recognition once people started coming home and had experiences, not just with PTSD, but TBI, I think about the Invisible Wounds of War report that came out of RAND that offered for many people the first real solid data and information about those experiences. You know, I think that the recognition that people weren't dying so much as being injured and what that looked yeah. like when they came home, you know that's going to happen, but you don't know what it's going to look like until they actually get home mm-hmm. and come into your homes and communities. And related to that, I think the issues around family caregivers, again, something in looking back we should have anticipated, but I don't know that we were well positioned to respond to their needs. Mm-hmm.
And of course, that's why we're here. But before we finish today, you know what I'm going to be coming back to ask you is, okay, so what? Because every conflict's going to be completely different. And what's your guidance to your future selves? But Morgan, do you want to add? And Morgan sold himself short, really, because Morgan has served as a dean of a school of professional psychology and is now running a professional association. So he, as is true of many people in the room, has been kind of inside the fence, outside the fence, served in multiple capacities, and I think has a great vantage point then to see what's been going on over the last few years.
So. I've gotten outside the fence in spite of people's attempts to keep me in. I think we call that escaping. But on September the 12th, which is a good frame, what happened to a number of us active duty people in the National Capital Area was we were all gathered up en masse, put in high-speed transports down the Beltway, and deposited in one of the big MTFs, in my case, Bethesda, where we sat and felt helpless. So it was quite clear from the outset that providing mental health services from the traditional MTF point of view and reference was not going to work. And that became only increasingly clear as time went on. Now, it's without selling the services short, but I think that this is something along the lines of the incremental change that Shelley is trying to keep us away from. Prior to 9/11, there had been numerous attempts, and some of which were modestly or substantially successful, to integrate mental health resources in the operational community. And those actually were, in many instances, not only cost-saving, but highly clinically effective maneuvers. But we found out, obviously, that what attempts that had been made up to that point were insufficient. What later became clear was that not only did we have to enhance that operational component and train people whose prior training had been pretty much clinical in the classical sense to work in the operational environment, but we also had to move away from traditional clinical mental health ways of looking at the problems that combatants, non-deployed personnel, families, and reservists were experiencing. And that is a challenge that we have not yet completely met. We still fight with, I think, an urge to pathologize. And that's something that I believe if we are going to make a truly transformational change, although this will take some time, we have to continue to resist that urge and continue to contextualize psychological difficulties in such a way that we enhance a spirit of hope and recovery and reintegration.
Great. Barbara, sure.
I'd just like to add something. One is when we set up the Pentagon Family Assistance Center, we had a child and child psychiatrist and psychologist at our beck and call as we were taking care of the children of the victims. And it was a marvelous, it was really helpful for us who are trying to deal with being in the Pentagon ourselves and trying to take care of the families, that having those assets right there that we could run down the hall and get somebody to help us when crises were occurring was really beneficial. So I agree with what you're saying. Secondly, I think one of the things about being prepared for the future is you never know what you're going to expect. So we were very reactive. I think that's the best way to describe it. So when the injuries were coming back, we realized that we did not have the support mechanisms for the families. And we, you know, in a matter of, I think, 2 weeks, set up the Military Severely Injured Center, including counselor advocates who would be directly working with family members to meet whatever need it was, whether it was to pay an electric bill back in Kansas or to buy groceries, because some of those families were eating Girl Scout cookies because they had no money. I mean, so it was just reacting to the needs and providing the service from an OSD perspective, to be an umbrella, if you will, until the services could then get their programs set up and moving forward to support their service members and their families.
Thanks. I'm going to put a question to the audience in a minute, so I'm just signaling Sarah that we're going to need the mic in a minute. But one of the things I think that has been the hardest about this work is that it's not a matter of identifying what you're going to do, because what the right thing is, you have no idea what it's going to be, because it's going to be a completely different sort of circumstance. But how you're going to do it, or what processes you need to have ready so that you can get the information or the resources that you need to do whatever it is that's going to be required. But that's a much harder thing. I want to open it up to the audience and just ask if there are people here, because many of you have been in a variety of positions over the last 15 years. You were watching all this transpire as well. How about the things that caught you by surprise or sort of signaled to you that, oh no, I am so not ready in my organization for this. We're going to have to do something completely different. Is there anybody that wants to just share the insights from their vantage point? Yeah, sure. There's a microphone coming to you. And if you don't mind, say your name and your role. Please stand up so people can see. Thank you so much.
The shy one in the audience. My name is Mary Winnefeld. I'm actually just with myself. My husband was 37 years in the military. I'm with a number of people in here when they need the Lorax to kind of be their advocate. I remember that day very well because my husband was deployed. He was the head of an aircraft carrier, 5,000 families. They were on a long deployment. And in fact, we were talking on the phone. He was deployed. He was off the coast of Africa. We were on the phone after the first plane hit. And just, you know, speculation at that point. When the second plane hit, he said, we're not coming home, because they were on their way home after a six-month deployment. He actually turned a ship around, and they were the first ones to deliver bombs. So I had a family support group at that time, and as typical with family support groups, 20 people, you know, out of all these families would maybe show up, but something in place. And this was back when, you know, I had a computer email list, but it was back when computers really couldn't handle a big list. So I had multiple lists that included family members that I was sending stuff out to. It exploded. And in November, in Norfolk, where we were stationed at the time, the family service center was overloaded. My ombudsman were overloaded. My ombudsman had family that were, you know, up in New York. Their family members were deployed. They were overloaded. I had people at my house, at my door. You know, the Family Service Center and even the MTFs were like, you know, we can't handle what's going on. And mom and dad back in Kansas thought their sons were probably one of the ones flying off the carrier delivering bombs, and you have to kind of walk them through this. But our support group meetings went from 20 to easily 2,000 people, if not more. So we were looking for auditoriums to have families in, you know, because nobody knew what was going on. There was the guys who had done a lot of this had gone through Norfolk. You know, our families were not coming home. They, you know, the guys that were on the ships were writing notes to on the bombs that they were going to be delivered. So I think, you know, it helped to have something in place, but we did not have support. You know, when you're away from DC, it's a completely, as everybody in here who's been, you know, active duty, it's a different world away from headquarters. And there aren't the, when it's something magnitude that happens, there's not support there. So it really is grassroots. And you've got to hope that your command has something in place. Mm-hmm. And then you've got to hope that you've been able to reach out. I used to stand outside of command functions and hand out flyers to get in touch with those families before we deployed. And I would have service members look at me and say, she doesn't need that, my family doesn't need that. And I would say, yes, they do, because something's going to happen while you're gone.
Yeah.
But I, you know, it's great that we do have all these things and we need everything going on in DC and setting these policies, but it needs to be dispersed out.
That's right. We can't forget all those other folks out there. Thank you very much. Well, and as you're all talking, you know, you get this sense of this huge urgency on September 12th, this very quick response. My mind can't help but flash forward to a ship with a big banner that said mission accomplished, and then a surge. And part of what we've been thinking about as we work on these ideas is the arc of war, some of which is predictable and some isn't. Everyone sprang into action really early, and then I suspect there were some tough moments later when people realized that Plan A isn't going to take care of it, and now there's a new thing. And I don't know if anyone out there has a particularly memorable recognition that you want to share about that later period. I don't know if there are people here who, when the surge was announced, for example, realized that their world was about to change. Anybody want to share anything? Joyce, I saw you nodding. Do you want to add one thought before we move on?
I think, you know, we early on, NMFA tried to connect with our volunteers, what's going on at the grassroots level, what's family support like, what are the families needing. We did a couple of surveys that involved focus groups and surveys to spouses. And I think one of those aha moments to me was 2005, I think, and I'm looking at Christina, she'll tell me. This was our second round of survey, and spouses really just wrote us volumes on what was going on in their lives. And at that time, the Army tagline was an army of one. And this one spouse wrote, I understand that it's an army of one, but why does that one have to be my husband? And to me, that spouse captured the cumulative effect of deployment so well and really heightened for us that we are in this for the long haul, and that these families already see this as a long haul. And so how do we expand what we do? How do we work with the Hill? How do we work with DOD to take some of those early quick things that were done and now either get them institutionalized or expand them out into the communities where the families are? So there was this initial phase of let's just pile a lot of different kinds of support, and then we had to say, okay, if we're going in this for the long term, or if families are experiencing this over the long term, how do we proceed with some better institutionalized things that are available across the board?
That leads in really nicely the next topic, but Morgan, you had something you wanted to add?
Well, I wanted to pick up not only on your comments, but on your phrase, the arc of war, and I would encourage us to also consider the arc of peace, because one of the things we know, at least from a clinical point of view, is that we don't see people in the treatment centers, in the VAs, for example, in the immediate aftermath of these conflicts. The current cohort in the VA, being treated for PTSD and related disorders is not an OIF-OEF cohort, it's a Vietnam cohort. And when you look back at service utilization over time, it's fairly consistent that after a period of time, you see increased acceptance of the sequelae of being involved in conflict, increased acceptance by the provider community and the community at large that there is an issue to be addressed. And so this is not really transformative, but I hope it's something we all pay attention to. That is a lesson from the past that we can learn by not neglecting these resources and programs simply because operational tempo has slowed.
Thank you. Yes, I do remember a phrase has stuck in my mind a long time from congressional testimony where one of the surgeons general, service surgeons general, said, you know, by the time the war started, we had become the medical infrastructure in the military had become perfectly sized for peace, which meant that they really weren't ready when needed in that capacity. Well, I want to move on now to a different topic now that we've laid the landscape a little bit. And I'd like you to think about innovations that you've seen over the last 15 years. And I'm particularly, of course, given that I direct the Military Family Research Institute, things that touch the lives of families, although pretty much everything does. And I'm also really interested in things that happen both within sectors and things that happened across sectors and helped us with synergy, helped us achieve potential. So I don't know who wants to start, but please feel free. Oh, Meredith's going to start and then get out quick.
So I was thinking about this question. As a researcher, again, I feel like our mission feels different than the mission of many other people, many other sectors. And so I was trying to think what really seemed innovative about this particular conflict. And it could be my naivete, but what strikes me right now is the unprecedented levels of support across nonprofit, philanthropic, the kind of public-private partnership work that has happened to support military families and veterans. So some of that has seeded, some of that has, you know, helped advocacy organizations. Some of it has established research centers like your own or IVMF. Some of it is working directly with DOD and VA to facilitate their efforts. And that feels different. That feels new. And it feels like something to work to ensure it doesn't go away as the issue attention cycle shifts to something, you know, shinier mm-hmm. and brighter and seemingly more compelling.
I have a follow-up question for you, but I also want to point out you sold yourself short a little bit too, because you're a military now veteran spouse, and Joyce is a military spouse, I know. But I know that you've been involved in a fairly innovative effort among scholars from multiple disciplines to try to think of ways that government data collection efforts could generate more useful information that would assist the nation in times of war. Can you talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, sure. I was reserving that for the next question, but
I didn't mean to steal your thunder.
No, it's fine. I mean, so I've been part of a group that sort of grows day by day of researchers that have been really trying to push for better data collection so that we, as in the research community, who, one thing I'll say, I think I can sell the academic research community as a resource that is ever present. We're not like a think tank where, you know, you don't have, spoiler alert, a large chunk of my salary is paid by my university to conduct research, whether or not you give me a grant or you buy my hourly rate to do that. And so when you have interested scholars who care about these issues, their time is already purchased. You can get us on the cheap, right, to do your work if you can collaborate and partner with us. The thing we need, we'll take your money. I mean, I'll guarantee we'll figure out a way to take your money.
I was going to say, and your
we'll
president is probably rolling
we'll
his or her eyes at the moment.
Figure out a way to ask for it. But what we really could use your partnership with is access to data and information and populations, access to populations so that we can collect new data. So this group of scholars has been working through all kinds of channels, whether it's to add better questions to things like the census, the American Community Survey, the Current Population Survey, the National Longitudinal Survey of Youth, ask questions on those data collection efforts that are national and meant to serve broad constituencies that help us tell the world something about the military experience. We have worked on efforts to try to get administrative data so that the stuff the organizations are already collecting anyway, leverage it to answer questions they need answered instead of spending millions of dollars on a new survey. And by the way, response rates are in the single digits, especially military families are especially, have especially low response rates. And so, you know, part of what we've been trying to do is to have a broad approach to get more creative and more efficient and effective means of collecting higher quality data at lower cost mm-hmm. across the board.
That would be a
great innovation if it was successful. I will say I think it's a work in progress at best.
I was going to say there are two forms of exquisite torture for researchers. One is to have a question about which you're passionate and you can't find any way to answer it. And the second is when someone suddenly shows up begging for the answer to the question that you've been dying to answer that you couldn't answer, which is exactly what happened at the beginning of the war. We had been trying to do a study of deployment for 2 years, and people were like, no, there are not so many deployments, we're not so interested. And then, of course, on September 12th or December 12th, everyone wanted to know about deployment, and we were empty-handed, and you know, you look foolish. So yes, we feel your pain. Joyce, you wanted to weigh in.
But just to add to that, and as advocates, we were getting hounded by Congress, DOD, anybody that we wanted to do something for military families. Where's your data? And we didn't have it. Nobody stood at the bottom of the steps to the plane when those soldiers and Marines went into Afghanistan and ask questions about how you doing now, how's your health, how's your family doing. Nobody asked their families. And so it took us too long to be able to figure out how to answer the question, how are families affected by war, when we didn't have good baseline information. And so one of the answers that I had to this question on innovations that I thought was particularly helpful was the MFRI research symposia, where you were gathering researchers, organizations, DOD, VA folks, to have a conversation about the kind of research that was going on to help inform all of us and give us all a sense of, okay, here's some gaps, here's some knowledge that we can use. And I think that was really important because we need those linkages. And I think there are a lot of the innovations I saw across sectors that really paid off are the conversations, whether it was the White Oak conversations of organizations, government, philanthropy, just joining forces itself. The benefit of having the First Lady and the Vice President's wife use that bully pulpit to re-energize support for military families in the middle of a very long war was critical, and because it brought so many folks from so many different sectors together. And then the other thing, it's not really an innovation, but I think it's important, it was the infusion of new blood to the advocacy efforts because of the creation of new veteran organizations, new family organizations, and individual advocates like my friend Meredith Beck here, who took causes and pursued them and supported folks. So having that entrance of new blood, new enthusiasm to the advocacy fight, new perspectives was so very important.
Mm-hmm. Can I ask you to say a little bit more about joining forces? And I suspect others of you will have things to say about joining forces. Many of you have longer experience than I do in the space, and so you'll know more than I about what kinds of things might be considered precedents or similar, or whether there weren't any. And can you just talk about, from the perspective of your sector, what was meaningful or important about that might generate some lessons for the future?
To me, the biggest benefit was, it was, you know, it was, this was 2009, you know, when the Obamas and Bidens came in, it was 2009, and we had been at this for a very long time, and I could sense from where we sat that the American public's focus on the war and the troops and the military families was kind of starting to drift away. We'd had other events, you know, lot of things in the news, and so what joining forces did was to use that bully pulpit to raise awareness and pull in folks who had not been really engaged. A lot, you know, the veteran employment, whole veteran employment issue, military spouse employment, pulling in the National Governors Association. You know, National Governors Association will respond to an invitation from the First Lady. And that's what happened, and we finally saw this effort with DOD and a lot of different players to get some changes on the military spouse licensure, for example. So having that focus brought more players, raised the visibility of the people they were serving with at a time when we needed that visibility back up in front of America.
Mm-hmm. Barbara, you've had a window into joining forces that's a little different from the rest of us because you've seen some of the inner workings perhaps a little more than some of us. Can you talk about some of the specific elements that you thought have been really important?
Well, to echo what Joyce said, it was without a doubt probably the most forward-thinking opportunity for us to get on the national scene about what are the issues facing military and veteran families. But I wanted to talk about innovation a little bit and
sure.
Parallel process. Please. So around 2009, and Eddie, you could correct me if I'm wrong, that's when we started our land-grant university partnership, and that really was, I think, very innovative that two federal agencies could work together to leverage their resources for a common cause. And from that, we've worked with Purdue, we've worked with University of Minnesota, University of Arizona, various land-grant universities to really cement the things that we're doing with strong evidence behind it. And the results are awesome. And that's one thing that I'm very hopeful that we can sustain for the long haul, because the land-grant university mission is to support the members of their community, and they include military members and veterans in that mission. And so the work has been amazing. Second, the president called for every department head to be a part of the Presidential Study Directive 9. Again, bringing every federal agency together to look at how they could support military and veteran families. And some of the ideas were really innovative, whether it was a free pass to the from the Department of Interior to the national parks, or Kathy, your issue with the museums. There were tangible things that happened for military families as a result of that Presidential Study Directive. So that force between joining forces from the First Lady and Dr. Biden, the Presidential Study Directive, and what we were doing within the federal government to work together to leverage those missions, I think is really innovative. And I think it's something that I wouldn't want to be put on a shelf and dusted off when the next contingency comes forward. It needs to continue day in and day out as we move forward.
Thanks. This is a heads up. I'm going to turn it to the audience in a minute. But before I do, I want to just say that Roy Brocious, the assistant director of Joining Forces, really wanted to be with us today. But the attorney's restrictions eventually became so onerous that she was afraid that no one else would be able to speak. And so she decided that discretion would be the better part of valor. And she's home writing her chapter. But we, of course, want Joining Forces to be represented. But now I want to turn it back out to you and ask any of you who wish to kind of nominate or describe innovations that you recall that you think really were memorable and important for us not to lose sight of, particularly those that help to create synergy across sectors. And I know for a fact that there are many of you in the room who could describe such things, so I encourage you to volunteer before I become the professor and call on you. Bob, just wait for a mic. It's right behind you. Thank you.
I think you've explained that very well. I think one of the things that we found in Texas was the fact that we had a lot of silos going on with governmental agencies. And as a result of that, everybody was doing really good things, but nobody knew what everybody else was doing. And so what ended up happening was a lot of resources got lost in the noise. So we put a coalition together. I'm over here.
Are we getting seasick looking at this screen?
I can start singing. Maybe Dean Martin will come out at me.
Let me ask our technical support. Would you prefer that Bob turn around? Does that make it easier for you? You can't really get it. Why don't you come? Just come forward.
Oh my gosh. Okay. So, any rate, to make a long story short, so what we ended up doing through the Society for Human Resource Management and a bunch of other folks is decided to walk off the curb and say, "Hey guys, this is crazy. We're all siloed. We've got tons of gaps. Why don't we put together a strategy to align everybody to execute across the state so that at the end of the day something actually cool could happen?" And that's exactly what we did. We started a program called the Patriotic Promise that basically created symposiums across the state to educate employers on the benefits of hiring veterans, as well as to keep in mind military families as they were being deployed and coming back and so on. I think the interesting part going forward, and I think you guys are seeing it dead on, but maybe not articulating completely, what we're seeing is the fact that a lot of cool things are happening, a lot of awareness is out there today. The problem is the sustainability. After success, people then start going back and getting back into the silos, getting back into, because now it's a competition again to some degree in terms of being able to do the cool program. We're currently working on something in Texas. I'm not sure I can articulate it right now. It's almost like a walk off the curb. It's like taking a core of what needs to happen from a transformational standpoint and take a giant leap forward. And like I said, we've just started walking off this curb. I'm not totally sure how much I can really say at this point because I want to be respectful to folks that I've been chatting with here recently in some other conversations that have gone on. But the interesting part is that, okay, so 3 or 4 years ago, Hire America, the radio stations are going, hire vets. Everybody's in that mood and everybody's going after doing that. Unfortunately, what's happening now is we need to retain them because we're getting them not necessarily in good job fits, and they get discouraged and frustrated and so on, and the unemployment's not gonna show coming out of corporate America what the actual unemployment rate is for our veterans coming back into civilian employment. So that's a huge gap that I think is something we need to start looking at. The other is from the behavioral side, the health and behavioral and all those kind of things. We've got folks out there that are hurting and they're not being touched. And I think a good example of that was the Vietnam era folks who are out there today and are still not getting touched. But the ones who've come back that have been in battle, that have seen bad things and so on, I'm not gonna label them PTS or whatever else because everybody's different and everybody's got their thing. But the interesting part about that is the fact that, and I'll just share this with you. Last year I was up here for a meeting for SHRM and we were waiting for a colleague. The colleague was female. She walked 2 blocks down the street. This particular gentleman saw her, was concerned about her safety, followed her there, and at the same time made a bond with her about protecting her. And when that happened, he went into a cycle. And he went up and down and up and down. And this gentleman was a very successful individual. I mean, six-figure financial wizard, the whole thing, and within an hour, it got very touchy in terms of what was going to happen next. There was a lot of concern for his particular behavior. There's a lot of concern for what he may or may not do. And God bless him. I felt bad for him because there's more of him out there, and I've experienced that since then. But the interesting part about that was that it wasn't about all the programs. It wasn't about all the things. I was concerned about my son-in-law because he seemed to be focusing in on him. And so I just jumped up and I gave the guy a hug and I said, "Sir, I really feel for your concern. I really feel for your heart, but you need to go." And when he pushed me back and looked me straight in the eye, I thought, here it comes. I got to be honest. I really felt. And he said, sir, I can't believe what you just did and how much that meant to me that you would hug me and feel my pain and understand me for just that moment. He said, I'll let you be. And he walked out. I never saw him again. But that's what we're facing. And I think from that standpoint, it's time to refocus maybe on the transformational side, to truly look at the behavior now, as well as all the other core things that come into play, military-family integration into our local communities, the employment side. In terms of corporate America today is about good job fit. It's not about warm bodies. And so the whole point of that is we need to see how we can assess those folks for the right career moves. And I'm pontificating here, and I apologize for that. But the cool part is direct contact and also direct connect in terms of truly matching up what the service member is going to bring to corporate America and what corporate America needs for that direct hookup. And I think that's the next spin.
Great. Do you want to give the mic to Patty? And while Patty's coming up, I'll just say, I mean, thank you for your contribution, Bob. But one of the things you're really getting at is this notion of the arc. The more spending goes up in the first part of a conflict, the more you can anticipate it's going to go down on the backside. It's predictable to some extent, I think. And that's what all the authors have been struggling to do, I think, is to distill those predictable things so that people don't get caught so much by surprise in the future, but then trying to figure out how to make that more orderly so that babies don't get thrown out with bathwater, I think, is a really big struggle in trying to figure out the guidance that could be offered based on what has been learned. But Patty, do you want to mention an innovation?
I do. I want to talk about unlikely partners. And I had the fortune of working for Joy's Razor at the National Military Family Association when one of the most unlikely partnerships came into existence. And that was when the Sierra Club, gave the National Military Family Association $18 million to send military children to camp, to send them outdoors. And we were a part of a three-pronged approach. It was NMFA through Operation Purple. It was Outward Bound through the program that they were doing for veterans. And it was the Sierra Club, who still has a Military Veterans and Families Outdoors program, if I'm not mistaken. Another innovation and unlikely partner was with Sesame Street. Sesame Street decided they needed to get into the supporting military families space. And many of us were very honored to sit on different advisory boards to help them create programming that still exists today that I'm extremely proud of and that I sent to my little two-year-old granddaughter, who is an Army child, I'll say, and I'm very, very proud of. But the transition program that they have for military children right now is incredibly important. None of these things would have existed without the openness of many of you in this room and those outside of this room who had the funding, who had the vision to say, how do we help military families? Because military families are America's families.
Great. Thank you. Oh, yeah. Let me give that to Linda. So I want to transition now to things that you wish you had gotten done or you wish somebody had done but couldn't get started or hadn't been able to achieve those goals. Can you identify some things that you'd like to say to your future self? Be sure you'd try this or do this, or I wish I had. Who wants to start? Looks like Barbara hit the button first.
One of the things, we were so engrossed in pushing out programs and resources and support that we did not have the time or the resources to look at research. Because that it is expensive and it would have taken away from the resources that we were pushing out. So my suggestion is that always that we embed an evaluation piece in anything that we, first of all, try to find something that is already evidence-based and then evaluate it within our military community, because a lot of times what's available from a research perspective in the civilian sector may not actually apply to our families. So that's what I would suggest.
Okay. And I forgot earlier when you were talking about your land-grant partnership, I feel some divided loyalty. Of course, I'm completely loyal to Purdue because that's where I've spent my whole career. But I am a Penn State alum, and I'm sure Eddie would want me to be sure to mention the Penn State Clearinghouse for Family Readiness. So I acknowledge my divided loyalty, but I wanted to recognize them. Joyce?
Yeah, I also had research and program evaluation on the list, and it's essential for programs from various charities. It's essential in terms of telling that advocacy story, and I don't think we're there yet, and so we need to continue to work that. I think for us as an advocacy community, it was easy to convey a link between service member readiness and family well-being at the height of a conflict. When the surge was in the news, when there were a lot of deployments, we could make that argument very easily. As wars taper down, it's harder and harder to cement that connection in the minds of people who control the money and the prioritization for resources. And so that we still have to work at that. I think the other issue that remains a work in progress is what exactly is the VA supposed to do to support veteran families? We're all still struggling. We don't have clear answers and a clear sense of what's in the art of possible for the VA. And so we have a lot of veterans families who really don't have much in the way of support as they're dealing with some of the issues around their veteran or just the transition out of the military.
Mm-hmm. And Morgan, you wanted to say something?
You know, it strikes me that all the discussants around this particular topic have been talking about data. And it's really hard to make an argument that data are transformative. The results of data can be transformative, but the data themselves usually aren't. But there is an exception, I think, in this case. And not only are they transformative in terms of the ability to share across institutions and stakeholders, but we actually now have something that we really didn't have 15 years ago. And we are starting to enjoy the benefits of analyzing very, very large data sets. And they're telling us some things that we need to pay attention to. So I obviously come from the treatment community, so I apologize. I'm going to have to, you know, constrain my comments to that. But I'd like to point out one program, and I'll circle back to your comments about the VA in a second, that I think is actually kind of transformative, and I don't even have a word for it right now. They're like disease management protocols, but they really aren't. And I think maybe a better term would be something like disease modeling protocols, but that's probably inaccurate. What the Veterans Administration is doing now is looking at large data sets and picking out seemingly disparate data points that lead to a pretty accurate, although preliminary, a predictive algorithm for people at risk for suicidal behavior. And the reason that they're able to do this is because they have the advantage of looking at centralized data sets for all the vets that they see. The Defense Health System has a similar data set called the M2 database, and it's been used in the past for disease management protocols. Unfortunately, these two data sets do not talk to each other. And indeed, from a humble clinician's point of view, it's very frustrating. You can't even get clinical information between the Defense Health System and the VA system, which is truly truly the art of the possible. It's just we haven't had the gumption to make that possible yet. So I would argue two things. One, the transformative nature of these very large data sets, which I think can be applied to many problems, including suicidal behavior, but also the fact that unless we accept the reality, which has been clinically apparent for decades, if not longer, that we cannot treat psychosocial problems in isolation. That is, we cannot just treat the veteran and expect them to improve in the context of the family system, et cetera. One of the things that we need to look very hard at doing, despite the bureaucratic and political obstacles, is to make the VA a TRICARE provider, such that military personnel and VA personnel would have access to the same system of care.
Thank you. So I want to transition now to the hardest question, which every author and every chapter really struggles with, because it is so hard. It's the so what question, because you can look back and say, I wish I knew this, or I did this great thing, or but so what? How do you transform that knowledge into something that you can use the next time? Because next time's going to look different. But they knew it was coming, and they've been wrestling with it for a long time, as have many of you in the room. So I'm interested in knowing now, what three things do you want to say to your future self? You know, the day you realize that transformative change is required, here are the things that you ought to do. Here's how you can do even better than I was able to do, or than we were able to do. And in particular, of course, I know you all care a lot about families, and so the question too is very much about military connected families. So, Morgan, your microphone's still on. Does that mean you want to start?
I'll be happy to say a little bit more, but I wasn't trying to get first in line here. So, three things that I would do differently, or that I wish were different the next time. One, we have to start thinking differently about how we conceptualize disorders like mild traumatic brain injury and post-traumatic stress and post-traumatic stress disorder. That's, I think, essential to successful treatment in the future. In part, it's not only coming up with better treatment protocols for these disorders, it's also continuing to research what constitutes PTSD and other associated disorders, what constitutes blast-related TBI, and how we can mark those problems. We have to have a better way, and we've thought and talked about this for a long time, of communicating these findings and evidence-based protocols to the people that see veterans and their families most, which are not people like me inside of MTFs or specialty mental health clinics. So those are things that I think we can work on now that will pay benefits in the future. The third thing I would, as I said just a few moments ago, we have to continue to look at how we can optimize our use of these very large data sets to give us insights that are not necessarily predictive, but can certainly help shape responses and help allocate resources in the right direction to make sure that we're treating everybody without unduly pathologizing those we most want to help.
Great, thank you. Who wants to go? Oh, Joyce?
Yeah, because I'd like to follow on with Morgan's part about how we convey what's going on with this population. And I think one of the things that I would like to convey to my future self is think seriously about the narrative of the military family that you convey. For certain audiences, advocates have sometimes had to, or charities have had to convey a message of weakness or need. And for other audiences, you know, our sense as a military family organization is we want to convey a message of resilience and strength, determination, but exhaustion. And so I think advocates and anybody in this space has to really consider how they're framing the narrative of the military family for external audiences who won't know much about the military family. Mm-hmm. And if you have another crisis, and this goes to my second one, learn the lessons from the last war, but don't expect to fight the last war again. People who aren't engaged in this community and with this community, unless there's a crisis, will try to fight the last war. And so your narrative about the military family becomes very, very important in educating them to help them support the families of this current crisis, whatever. And I think part of that, building that narrative for anyone who's serving military families, is you have to nurture your grassroots. For us, it was our volunteers. We had to keep our connection with our volunteers strong because they were our eyes and ears on the ground. We had to use new communication tools and platforms to reach out in new ways to the military families we were serving, to always make sure we had the narrative right. And so that has to be a constant for our, you know, our future advocates, our future workers on behalf of families, is to maintain those connections with the grassroots and be prepared to nurture them as they're going through just the life of a military family.
Great, thank you. That question about narrative is so important, and I want to acknowledge that there will be a chapter in the book focusing on journalism. And I'm so appreciative to Karen Jowers and Patricia Keim for being willing and able to step back and reflect a little about narrative and their role in shaping narrative and their wishes for things that perhaps could or should be different in the future. So I just want to express my appreciation publicly for your effort. Barbara, would you like to say something?
I would think for my future self, it's something that, you know, it's again, it's today, not waiting for the next conflict to happen, is to really have a pulse on the changing demographics of our families. I mean, right now we're looking at LGBT families, we're looking at more women in combat roles, we're looking at the ops tempo of our special forces. We need to be looking at shifting societal changes in marriage, for example. You know, our service members aren't getting married. So what does that mean if they don't have an ID card? Does that mean we don't serve them? And also looking at the definition of family. It's more than just the spouse and the children. We have to look at it more holistically. So I think we have to really keep tabs on that, and we need to know, again, learn from our civilian counterparts on how to provide services for different families.
Mm-hmm. You make a really good point related to this notion of process. It's not so much make sure you're ready to serve family type X,
right,
but make sure that you're monitoring diversity so that you can match what you're doing to the diversity that you have at that time.
Absolutely.
So great, thank you. Mm-hmm. Other thoughts that people on the panel want to add? And then I'm going to open it up for Q&A.
I'll add my last thought, which maybe I'm being too confident here, but from the research community, I would say we actually need to keep doing what we've been doing all along. It was great in the research community to have a lot of people who suddenly became interested in this topic, either through maybe some opportunistic views that this is an opportunity to do something, or because of genuine interest fostered by things like joining forces. We have to keep our eyes on the prize that in some ways we are the ready reserve who can continue to provide the information that the policy folks and the advocates need when they're called upon in the time of crisis. Because as you said, Joyce, when Congress comes to you, Congress doesn't come to me. I'm sort of thankful. They go to you. But you need the bench of people who are continuing to sustain the work. And then the other thing I would say is even the next so-called crisis might not be something that's seen as a crisis by lots in the community. Military family life is a slog, whether it's through a deployment, whether it's through repeated PCSs, whether it's through intensive training. I mean, day-to-day life in the military, even on September 10th, wasn't easy. And one of the things we should keep in mind is that we don't necessarily get to determine what feels like a crisis for military families, because that routine experience can feel like a crisis for military families. So maintaining our eyes on serving that population, regardless of what it is, whether it's a war or whether it's peace, those things, they'll always be a need.
Mm-hmm. Great. Oh, yeah, Joyce, please.
I just have one more comment, and I think we were very fortunate over the last 15 years to enjoy very high support for our troops and their families from the American population. Nonprofits found new donors, we had companies hiring veterans, we had people doing care packages in their communities for troops they didn't know. There was this outpouring of support. So one of the things our future selves have to just keep in the back of our minds is the worst that can happen, which would be our military may be asked to do something that's not popular with America. And how do we find the ways to make sure those families are supported even when what the military is doing is not supported?
Thank you. Morgan?
Yeah, I'd just like to put that in a slightly different context. I totally agree with what you've said. But I think it's important for us to stop talking about the next conflict, because the next conflict is already here. I mean, nobody has declared, unless I missed it, you know, an end to the long war. And so it's just the shape that the next escalation is going to take rather than, you know, a de novo conflict that I think we need to be prepared for. And I just wanted to point out throw out one little factoid about your comment regarding LGBT families. The largest single provider of services to LGBT personnel anywhere happens to be the VA, with over a million LGB and soon to be transgendered personnel seeking care. And so we do need to come up with better training models to accommodate that diverse population.
Thank you, Morgan. So now I want to turn to all of you. Many of the people in this room, I know you're in positions of leadership. You have been in positions of leadership. You've experienced recent years. I'm sure many of you have had reflections about ways that you think things could have rolled out better or differently. I'm sure you've had thoughts about, I hope somebody in the future doesn't have to go through what I went through. This is your chance to try to identify some of those lessons so that we can try to capture them and make sure that they're available to your future self. So what are the things that any of you would like to nominate, that you would like to say to your future self? Renee and then Meredith.
Renee Campos with MOA. I think, looking back, if I could say to myself, being in the Pentagon and working with all of you, that one of the things we didn't still have yet to do is really connect our government, the Pentagon, VA, with, and our government as a whole, with the American public. And I think that we have done a lot to, and we worked a lot after the PFAC, and many.
Wait, what was that?
The Pentagon Family Assistance Center after that for many years. And it was kind of the precursor to the joining forces and White Oak, and you know, due to our visionary Meg Falk, we never turned people away to collaborate. Unfortunately, within the bureaucracies of our government, we have not broken down some of the barriers that don't allow us to go further and connect with organizations and others, recognizing that government can't do it all. So I think there's more work to be done. I think we all want to be part of that. And so I think that's something that we need to continue to repeat, and we're constantly having new leadership, we're constantly having new organizations come into this space. So we all stand on the shoulders of folks that came before us, and we need to keep the mantra going that this is important, and it needs to be important to Congress, it needs to be important to the folks in uniform and the people that, you know, lead our country, but it's important to us all.
Great. Thank you very much. Meredith?
She's not going to let me have it. She knows me well. I'm going to be pretty specific, actually. Renee mentioned that the silos haven't been broken down. The fact that Rory Brocious was not allowed to come here and speak to this group of people is ridiculous. And the ethics, I mean, not on her part, but on the fact that the ethics regulations are preventing conversation that needs to happen on those facts. So, and that's not, it's not only just her, it's on the services being able to request support, the VA being able to request support when they need it. So that's number one, probably. Number two is also very specific, allowing marital counseling through TRICARE. The MFLACs are some of the greatest people out there, but allowing marital counseling for specifically to the injured community, the whole community, but also focused on those who have experienced injuries. Speaking of the people who have experienced injuries, paying attention to the families who were injured early on, because they're the canaries in the coal mine. All of those families that we've seen from this conflict, especially, that's the one I'm familiar with, and I also don't stop talking, so sorry about that. They're the ones who are experiencing the problems now, and then recognizing those as trends as they move on, and then suddenly an explosion happens of many, many families experiencing that same thing, specifically within the caregiver community, as you see that the Dole Foundation is focused so well on. And then one that always gets a good eye roll from a lot of people is, we've talked about a lot of different organizations and the coming together and the innovations. The group that has not remotely innovated is Congress. And when it comes to, that's why I always get the eye roll. When it comes to, I was a congressional staffer for 8 years. I love them, but this is where I think one of the problems start and probably has the most direct impact on the people who are experiencing this at the operational level and the families themselves. The congressional staffs and the congressional committees, my aha moment was when I was the policy director for another organization after Walter Reed, and there was the first ever joint committee hearing between the Senate Armed Services Committee and the VA committee. The aha moment of that was a staffer walked up to me afterward and said, those families who were testifying didn't really know what they were talking about because they were using the language from the VA, not the Armed Services Committee. And the aha moment was, no, you actually don't understand what the opposite side is. You don't know that language. So Joyce is laughing at me because I've been saying this for quite some time, that a joint select subcommittee between the two that can actually have mutual language to address, especially as the VA is addressing more family issues and more family programs, to be able to have similar language so that ultimately those families aren't hearing two different net words to refer to the same exact program. So that's my
thank you
speech.
Very much.
Sorry.
Steve?
Mary's jumping up. Yeah. Sorry, I'm going to just really quick add on to this. Sorry, Steve. I happen to be on Elizabeth Dole's board, so a couple of things. First, and I'll try to remember this, TRICARE, and then also talking about a situation with the Dole Foundation. TRICARE, and I understand wanting to open it up and making them providers, but I would say for families, we need to be able to give them more options in healthcare. It's not working right now at all, especially in the mental health arena. Having a family going into an MTF and sitting down with someone who's in uniform, it doesn't work. They need to go where they feel comfortable. Our caregivers need to go where they feel comfortable. So, and I know you can do TRICARE standard, but it pays absolutely nothing. And again, DOD has led the way a lot in many other areas. I think this is maybe where we can maybe try to lead the way in mental health as well, because as a country, we have a huge deficit in mental health care providers, support, finances. We have a lot of military families that have taken out second mortgages to try and pay for health care on the outside where it's not covered. And again, I'm not slamming DOD. I was there for many years. The other thing that really concerns me, and I've also worked with Joining Forces from the early day, and I worked with them on doing a TBI PTS conference back in 2011. And again, they had the bully pulpit, and I used that because they were gonna bring in all these people from the American Psychology Association, from universities to the American Nurses Association, and they were gonna bring them in for two hours. And I went and said to Joining Forces, I said, you've got all these people coming in from across. Can I have them, you know, and we'll do your round table, but can I? And I took them up to Walter Reed. We went through the whole continuum of care, and I've had the fortunate experience also of doing the whole continuum of care, being out at a FOB in Afghanistan through Landstuhl, and so kind of really giving them and educating them, because you're right, they really do not understand us. They want to support us out there, but they don't understand us. So we went from a two-hour, I had them for a day and a half, did an icebreaker at my house, got all these people in one room. So I really, if we can keep that sort of too, including them, and not look at them as from a, you know, from Venus or wherever. The other thing that really concerns me is because we did have that bully pulpit, and that doesn't mean that it should necessarily, Joining Forces, stay inside the government. But I really worry about that bully pulpit that was there for us. Mm-hmm. because I told Tina Chen, Mrs. Obama's chief of staff, I said, joining forces to me at the very beginning looked like just another PR thing. I said, you really got to make it so that it's more than that. And I really do believe Dr. Biden and Mrs. Obama took it to the next level. I worry about this next one because of some of the rhetoric that's been out there with our future president. And I'm not, you know, I'm not one where I'm not a Democrat or Republican, I'm not trying to say, but I do worry about what's going to happen next and where is that voice going to come from. You know, it's not coming from the East Wing. It doesn't sound, you know, he wants a bigger military, but does he understand the consequences? If you're going to have a bigger, and if you want to go in and bomb a place, think about what happens, as we all know, afterwards. Mm-hmm. You've got to have the finances there to take care of our people. And as Meredith said, we both have some friends that were injured early on in 2004, and those poor folks are still struggling. The resources aren't there. So I really worry about all the rhetoric. So somehow if we can get that to our future friends out there, and I know there are people in here probably that are working on some of the transition committees and White Oak working on a paper, but.
Yeah, thank you very much. Steve?
It is not easy to follow Meredith Beck and Mary Winnefeld.
Well, and Steve, remember we had Donald Trump at one of our meetings.
We did.
For caregivers.
Thank you for mentioning that.
Yeah, before he actually announced his candidacy at the event.
He did. Yeah, we
yeah
feel really proud of that. I'm Steve Schwab. I'm executive director of the Dole Foundation. And I want to start by thanking Shelley. Your leadership has been extraordinary since the convening a year ago, September. I think you're showing the value that you expressed and hoped you would have at that original convening, and I think this discussion is a continuation of that. And Patty, thanks for hosting us. I want to be very specific, as Meredith was. I'm a newer leader to this sector, and I'm humbled and privileged to be a part of it and feel really passionate about the work that I do, as I know everybody in this room does. But too many times, and not so much the case today, I'm happy to say, but I come into these rooms and see a lot of the same people. And I think that's by virtue of the fact that there are a lot of wonderful organizations who are carrying the bulk of the work, and we know who many of those organizations are. But what I've come to realize, I think many of us know, is that fighting this conflict, this ongoing conflict, reintegrating these families successfully, is a nationwide effort. And there are a lot of organizations across this country that as yet have not realized their full potential in supporting folks who are deployed and folks who need to come back and reintegrate into their own community. So I think my future self and our future selves should challenge ourselves to spread the net and cast the net wider as it relates to engaging, especially those in the nonprofit and community setting, communities themselves. I know mayors and community leaders that we're talking to are still scratching their heads trying to figure out how to successfully support families in their own communities to actually find them so that there's a disconnect. And I think those of us that are inside the bubble in Washington have to challenge ourselves to break through that bubble and reach into the communities all across this country to engage those organizations at the local level. And I think that's something I've noticed pretty much right away, and I think really, really important moving forward.
Great. Thank you for that contribution. I'm going to give our panelists about 1 minute each to share some kind of closing thoughts to the panel, and then we're going to transition to our other activity for the day. But I do want to encourage all of you to continue this line of thought and to share. I mean, I'm happy to send you the list of the authors and the chapters, and if you want to correspond with the author and try to get some ideas in there, I hope that you will. There'll be another session like this in the spring that we hope, and that'll be right when we're sort of closing down the content. And we've taken a long time to do this, but it's because it's about the process. It's not about it's not just about the destination, and we want to engage as many organizations as we can so that in the end, All of these sectors are thinking about their battle plan, and they're ready to mobilize. So let me invite each of the panelists to take about 1 minute, and if you have any final thoughts that you'd like to share before we transition to our next activity, please feel free. Joyce?
Well, I just wanted to build on what you just said. All of us are part of some organization. Even if we are an advocate of one, we have to think about how do we prepare our own battle plan. And you know, my board chair, Gail McGinn, is here, and one of the things that our organization needs to be doing constantly is thinking about how do we ensure our own organizational capacity, our flexibility, our ability to prioritize and be as proactive as possible, even as circumstances change among the people we serve, or a new Congress comes in, or a new president comes in. So I think that organizations have to spend time on building their own battle plan and coming up with a structure. You know, we as an organization had to build our flexibility, our support for our staff, our support for our volunteers as we were gearing up to do what we needed to do to support military families in war. I would hope my advice to my successor and my future board members would be, let's start working on that now.
Thank you. Meredith?
Joyce sort of stole what I was gonna say. As a professor, you know, part of what I do is research, but part of what I do is education, teaching, training, and so one of the things that I see as my mission is to cultivate the next generation so that it's not me, the literal me is my future self, but it's those who come after me. And so engaging those folks in that work right now so that they're seeing this process and they are ready to take the reins as when it needs to be is something that's important, I think, in my sector. We need to refresh our own ranks. The other thing that maybe it goes without saying in this room is military families are stakeholders, but they're also contributors to all of this advocacy, research, policy, service provision that we're doing. And so we need to keep in mind that we need to be as open and flexible and provide them with the most opportunity to contribute in this space, not just as research subjects or not as catchy stories to promote in a report, but actually to do this work on behalf of their own community.
Thank you. I resonate with what you say. I have one graduate student at the moment who's really motivated to overhaul family support in DOD, and one motivated to design and create family support in the VA. And so our future is in good hands if just I don't mess up in the training. That's right. That's right. Morgan?
Kind of along those lines, I would urge a little bit of caution for those who are seeking that one transformative concept that's going to alter everything, because I don't necessarily think it's out there. I think that transformation comes from utilizing differently a lot of what we already have. We need to use it more effectively, more collaboratively, etc. But in the final analysis, the problems that we're facing aren't going to change. The scale of those problems may, we hope not, but it might, but the problems themselves are what we're seeing today. And so how we use the systems and the information we have in place now to better outcomes for folks currently, I think, is going to be the best predictor of how we do in the future.
Thank you. Barbara?
I think our greatest challenge is making our military families aware of the resources that we have available to support them. And so my call to action would be, how can we utilize these marvelous organizations to help get the word out and making sure that we connect the right resource at the right time to the right person?
Thank you. Thank you all very much. Can we thank our panel? You all can stay put for just a few more minutes. I know you can see the wine right from where you sit. We'll get there shortly. I just have one more happy duty before we move to that. So today I'm really pleased to announce the presentation of the 2016 Excellence in Research on Military and Veteran Families Award. And Sarah, if there's something that I need to have with me to do this, let me know. Since 2000, we at the Military Family Research Institute at Purdue University have worked to develop, encourage, and promote rigorous research on behalf of military and veteran families. We're committed to helping organizations that work directly with military families to use such research to create and strengthen their policies, practices, and programs. And we want to recognize the excellent work that other researchers are doing to generate new insights about families who serve. We try to do those things ourselves, of course, as well. But we really see ourselves as a convener of our community, and a service that we can provide is to try to raise visibility of good research and to try to shorten the distance between the people who apply research and the people who conduct research. Toward that end, MFRI created an award a year ago to recognize the single scientific article published in a given year that combines exceptional rigor with important insights about military and veteran families. Nominations for the award are neither solicited nor accepted. Instead, this year a panel of 16 reviewers examined every article found in an extensive search of scientific journals. The initial list of candidates was 500 articles. Multiple rounds of review yielded the finalists and the winning article. I'd like to acknowledge the work of the reviewers, some of whom are here, and thank them for their efforts. Julie Wargo Akins at Wayne State University, Julie Cederbaum at University of Southern California, Ellen DeVoe at Boston University, Abby Gewertz at the University of Minnesota, Lisa Gorman at the Michigan Public Health Institute, Ben Carney at the University of California at Los Angeles, Michelle Kelly at Old Dominion University, Meredith Claycamp at the University of Maryland, Leanne Knoblick at the University of Illinois, Mary Jo Larson at Brandeis, Jennifer Lundquist at University of Massachusetts, James Martin at Bryn Mawr, Linda Nichols at the Memphis VA Medical Center, Lyndon Riviere at the Walter Reed Army Institute of Research, Valerie Stander, who's here at the Naval Health Research Center, Don Vogt at the National Center for PTSD. Today, I'm pleased to announce the top three articles in this year's competition. I would first like to recognize an article published in the journal Psychiatric Services entitled Characteristics and Use of Services Among Literally Homeless and Unstably Housed U.S. Veterans with Custody of Minor Children. The authors are Jack Tsai, Robert Rosenheck, Wesley Caspro, and Vincent Kane. This article is one of the only efforts in the past decade to document medical and mental health problems among homeless veterans with children, and found that nearly one-third of homeless women veterans and one-tenth of homeless male veterans have minor children under their custody, which raises concerns about the parenting environments experienced by their children and the needs of these families, not just these veterans. The second article I will recognize is titled Perspectives of Family and Veterans on Family Programs to Support Reintegration of Returning Veterans with Post-Traumatic Stress Disorder. It was published in the journal Psychological Services, which coincidentally is edited by Pat DeLeon, with whom I think many of you are familiar, and was authored by Ellen Fisher, Michelle Sherman, Jean McSweeney, Jeffrey Pine, Richard Owen, and Lisa Dixon. Also one of the first studies of its kind, this article documents the preferences of veterans and family members about including family members in veteran-oriented programming. Both groups strongly supported including family members in programs that facilitate veterans' post-deployment readjustment and reintegration. Both favored content focused on information, practical skills, support, and gaining perspective about their partner's experience. But family members gave more priority to parenting-related issues and supports they and their children needed during and after deployment. The winning article of the 2016 competition is entitled War and Marriage, Assortative Mating and the World War II GI Bill. It appeared in the October 2015 issue of Demography, a scholarly journal published by the Population Association of America. The authors of the article examined the unexpected impact of the GI Bill on later marriages and family lives of those service members and veterans who used it. We're pleased to be honoring authors who examined a critical implication of post-World War II policies, policies that are once again in large-scale implementation in the form of the post-9/11 GI Bill in such a rigorous and innovative way. We believe that the conclusions of all of the finalists' research will further affirm the importance of high-quality research about military and veteran families and should help to focus the policies, programs, and practices of the future. Accepting the article on the author's behalf is Jeremy Moulton of the University of North Carolina. His co-authors are Matthew Larson of Lafayette College, T.J. McCarthy of the University of Southern California, Marianne Page of the University of California, Davis, and Ankur Patel of the U.S. Department of the Treasury. On behalf of the Military Family Research Institute, it's my pleasure to present the 2016 Excellence in Research Award to Jeremy and his co-authors. Please join me in welcoming him to the podium.
I know there's some good stuff over here, so I'll be short. My co-authors and I want to thank the Association of the United States Army for sponsoring the event, and also thank the MFRI for the award, obviously. And more importantly, for highlighting research that is relevant. I'm in a public policy department, and it's important that we can get practitioners and academics together and actually get them to interact, and also to write research that actually is helpful. And I really appreciate you going through and sifting through 500 papers, and it's nice to know somebody's actually read your work, and it's also nice to know that they actually like it. So those two things are great. I've really enjoyed today as well. Bob Cartwright, your comments have actually sparked a few things in my mind on things I'm going to look at. But this paper builds on work by John Bound and Sarah Turner, who found that the World War II GI Bill increased men's education levels, their college education. And we sort of got interested. This is a paper that we started in graduate school. Marianne Page was one of our professors, and we sort of wondered, you know, did this have farther-reaching effects? And we wanted to know, sort of also to test a theory by Gary Becker that, you know, men and women match on education. And so we were able to use the GI Bill as sort of a shock to men's education to see if they were able to match on women who had more education. And we found that, yes, they did. They actually married women that had more often a high school degree. It's not that they met in college, it's that they were able to marry somebody who had more education. And that has sort of far-reaching implications both for their kids, but also for spousal relations and things like that. And I think that it's important as we think about the different policies that we should think about not just sort of the direct effects, but these unintended consequences, whether they're good or bad. And that's sort of the last thought I would have. So thank you.
Well, in the best tradition of Oprah's favorite things, I have MFRI challenge coins to give the panelists, which I'll do at the end, but I also have gifts for all of you. I'm very pleased to tell you that the publishers of each of the top three articles that I announced have made those articles available at their websites at no charge, so you'll each be able to access them easily, and we'll send you a link so that you can get to them easily. In addition, we've prepared a list of all of the nominated articles, along with what I call a tapas-sized serving of the findings, in the hope that you will acquire and read the articles and engage with the authors, who I assure you will be very happy to be contacted by you for exactly this reason. We labor in the vineyard and wonder if anybody ever reads what we have done. You will be asked to complete evaluations of today's event. I'm sure you're not surprised to hear that from a researcher, and I hope that you will do so. I know Patty's going to return to the podium, but let me just offer my thanks for your participation, for the wonderful insights that the panelists have shared, and to Jeremy and his colleagues for their great research. Thank you very much. Patty? Patty?
I don't know about you guys, but I'm so proud to be a part of this community. Thank you so much. This was incredible, an incredible way to spend 2 hours. And I can't thank you enough for all of your insights and perspectives. And congratulations, Jeremy, to you and the folks that you work with on that paper. I wanted to say that we at AUSA are committed to bringing you more of these types of conversations, more of these types of gatherings and forums. But we need you. We need you to join us. And we need you to think about being a member, being a voice for military families, being an expert contributor. There's many ways that you can participate and be a part of who we are. Because you do make a difference in this world. There's many people that I see in this room that I just admire so much because of the work that you all do, the passion with which you do it. And you do it selflessly. You do it for a lot of different reasons. And most of all, you do it because you care about military families. And I think today's panel and conversation was very reflective of that. Now, we have some wonderful goodies for you to munch on before you go home to dinner. And also, yes, we've got some nice libations. I wanted to also just say that many of you probably got an email this morning that surprised you and maybe made you sad, but I wanted to acknowledge Barbara Thompson, a very dear, wonderful colleague who will be retiring at the end of this year from DOD after 41 years of service. Barbara, we are indebted to you. So please join us for the reception, get to know Jeremy, talk to the panelists, and we do have a little goodie as well from AUSA, so you can thank you so much.